In 1962, 15-year-old Peter Parker is bitten by a radioactive spider while attending a science exhibit. The bite mutates his biology, allowing him to cling to any surface with the proportionate speed, strength, and agility of a spider. Earlier that year, feeble scientist Dr. Bruce Banner is bombarded with gamma radiation during an experimental weapons test. As a result of the contamination, he is transformed into a hulking grey monster whenever night falls. Just 6 months prior, desperate to beat the Soviet Union into space, Reed Richards builds his own spacecraft. In his haste, he fails to include the proper shielding against cosmic rays. Richards, along with his fellow astronauts Ben, Sue, and Johnny, are left with hair-raising abilities. At the dawn of the Marvel Age of comics, the majority of the publisher's output was monster and suspense titles. And in fact, the early Marvel superheroes had more in common with the protagonists of a horror story than the archetypal superhero of the 1940s and 50s. These were not infallible paragons of virtue, but deeply flawed human beings, whose physical and frequently gruesome transformations reflected their internal struggles. Traditionally, horror fiction plays on our primordial fears of the unknown. It torments us with boogeymen at the window and things that go bump in the night. These fears are often external, but body horror shines a spotlight on ourselves, to the internal. While a good scary movie can really get under your skin, a body horror story is already under there. Something alien and unfamiliar is inhabiting your body, violating your very nature, and you're trapped inside with it. Consider David Cronenberg's 1986 film, The Fly, the story of a brilliant scientist played by Jeff Goldblum who invents an experimental teleportation pod. Spurred on by jealousy over his lover Ronnie, Dr. Seth Brundle becomes the first human test subject of his miraculous invention, but he is unaware of a housefly that has joined him in the transmitter pod. Initially, being fused with the fly at a molecular genetic level increases Brundle's strength and stamina. For all intents and purposes, this is the classic superhero origin story. But before long, both the audience and Ronnie are forced to watch idly as Brundle pays the ultimate price for his pursuit of science. Compare this to the story of the Incredible Hulk. Is he man or monster? Or is he both? Stan Lee and Jack Kirby took inspiration from the early Gothic literature that was the progenitor of the body horror genre. Hulk is Frankenstein's monster meets Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde through the lens of Cold War paranoia. A gifted physicist, a freak accident, a doomed love. Both of these stories deal with the desire for knowledge and the consequent loss of humanity. They reflect our corporeal societal anxieties and ask the question, what if science goes too far? In body horror, the graphic and psychologically disturbing violations of the human form are usually marked by a loss of conscious control over the body. Just as Dr. Bruce Banner loses control over his thoughts, his impulses, and his darkest desires when he becomes the Hulk. With The Fly, Cronenberg wanted to construct an allegory of aging and disease, in order to play upon our anxieties of physical vulnerability. The fact that Dr. Brundle fuses with a common housefly, an insect commonly associated with illness and decay, is no accident. Similarly, it was no accident when Stan Lee chose to base one of his most iconic co-creations on the creepiest of crawlies, and the subject of many people's most deep-rooted fears, the spider. In Spider-Man's origin, Peter Parker's adolescent body is the site of a metamorphosis. The radioactive spider bite poisons his blood, infecting him and infiltrating his body. In the character's first appearance in Amazing Fantasy No. 15, Parker is visually horrified and disturbed by his newfound powers. With the ability to crawl on walls and ceilings and contort his body in all sorts of weird and wonderful ways, Spider-Man's powers are intentionally icky and gruesome, further establishing his origin as an allegory for puberty. This coming-of-age story sees the teenage Peter going through massive changes, both physical and emotional. The loss of Uncle Ben is a hard lesson learned about great power and great responsibility, but it also represents the loss of innocence and the end of childhood. Parker's awakening as Spider-Man and the physical transformation that comes with it are monstrous to him, and he hides his identity partly because his new abilities are a source of shame. Spidey eventually comes to embrace his powers and the responsibility that comes with them. But the body horror tropes of resisting and fearing physical change and the violation of our bodies by something alien can be found throughout many classic Spider-Man stories. In fact, Spider-Man's entire rogues gallery is swarming with tragic tales of body horror victims. Dr. Kurt Connors, convinced that he has unlocked the secrets of reptilian limb regeneration and desperate to overcome his own disability, transforms himself into the Lizard. Dr. Otto Octavius is a gifted physicist and inventor whose robotic arms fuse with his nervous system, turning him into the maniacal Dr. Octopus. The Rhino, The Sandman, Morbius the Living Vampire, Venom, Carnage, the list goes on and on. The abject terror of Peter Parker's transmogrification is played up even more in Sam Raimi's 2002 film adaptation of Spider-Man. Most well known at the time for his cult classic Evil Dead franchise, a series that blurred the lines between body horror and action comedy, Raimi brought his own unique brand of splatstick humour to the friendly neighbourhood wall crawler. From Norman Osborn's terrifying transition into the Green Goblin, to the way that Peter loses consciousness and ergo control in a feverish haze of nightmarish imagery. Sam Raimi really leans into the puberty symbolism too, with Parker's increased strength, hair where there never used to be hair, and the organic webbing, a mysterious, sticky, bodily fluid which initially causes much embarrassment to Peter. This scene in the film's sequel, Spider-Man 2, in which Dr. Octopus awakes in an operating surgery, his mechanical limbs having taken over his mind, is straight from the horror handbook. From the gloomy lighting to the claustrophobic shot composition, and even the blood-curdling sound design. But Raimi isn't the only horror director to make the leap into superhero movies. Before crafting his modern-day space opera about a ragtag bunch of assholes, writer-director James Gunn created a body horror modern classic with his 2006 film Slither. The language of horror can be found all over Guardians of the Galaxy and its sequel. Take, for example, the character of Nebula, a biomechanical humanoid who is kept in flux as her adopted father Thanos continuously interchanges her body parts. She is tortured and dehumanized, her body pushed beyond its natural limits. And then there is this scene in Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2, in which extensions of Ego's consciousness engulf the Earth, in an obvious allusion to the 1958 godfather of body horror, The Blob. In 2008's Iron Man, Tony Stark is the quintessential body horror protagonist. Like Seth Brundle in The Fly, or Herbert West in Stuart Gordon's Reanimator, Stark is a brilliant mind who revels in toying with elements beyond his control. He is the postmodern Prometheus. But pride comes before a fall, and Tony's arrogance combined with his obsessive quest for knowledge and power forms a deadly cocktail. After a traumatic injury, he is forced to create a device to stop the shrapnel inching ever closer to his heart, blurring the lines between man and machine. The very thing that powers Iron Man's superheroics sits in a gaping, fleshy hole in his chest. The arc reactor is a foreign object in Stark's body. It keeps him alive, but the cost is a violation of his humanity and a constant reminder of his fallibility. Compare this scene, in which Pepper Potts helps Tony upgrade his arc reactor, to this scene from 1983's Videodrome, in which the protagonist, Max Wren, discovers that his torso has transformed into a sort of organic VCR. Although one scene is played for laughs, the imagery is disturbingly similar. From one Iron Man to another, just as the American superhero comics of the Silver Age reflected the public mistrust of science and the looming threat of all-out nuclear war, films like 1988's Akira and 1989's cyberpunk horror masterpiece Tetsuo the Iron Man offer a futuristic vision of post-Hiroshima Japan. The themes of government failure and industrial corruption are rife in both stories, but Shinya Tsukamoto's tale of a Japanese salaryman haunted by violent sexual hallucinations and his slow transformation into a biomechanical monster is an uncompromising tour de force of terror. Tetsuo the Iron Man contains some of the most visceral special effects and unsettling imagery that the body horror genre has to offer. Whether it be a mutant bug bite, the fallout from a gamma bomb explosion, or the curse of a deranged metal fetishist, all of these narratives are built around a character's accidental and uncontrollable change to their physicality. But where body horror protagonists pay the ultimate price for their hubris, superheroes are empowered by their new abilities. Perhaps the most valuable lesson we can take away from these stories is in how we deal with trauma and transformation. In the 2007 horror comedy film, Teeth, writer and director Mitchell Lichtenstein tells the story of Dawn O'Keefe, a teenage girl who is horrified to discover that she has vagina dentata, or vaginal teeth. This coming-of-age story shares more of its DNA with a stereotypical superhero origin than with the films of David Cronenberg. At the start of the film, Dawn is a member of a Christian abstinence group. She is afraid of her own sexuality and of giving in to her desires. Once again, we see the themes of sexual awakening, loss of innocence, and subsequently loss of control. Dawn develops an attraction to another member of the group, Toby, and after developing a relationship, she apprehensively acts on her attraction. After Toby's advances become physical and aggressive, a struggle ensues, which culminates in him attempting to rape her. However, Dawn fights back and inadvertently bites off his penis with her vagina. As a result of this, Dawn fears getting close to anybody that she cares about. She becomes afraid of her own desires because she knows that intimacy leads to people getting hurt. I'm reminded of this scene from 2000's X-Men, in which a young Rogue discovers her mutant abilities during a formative sexual experience. Puberty and the changes that come with it are fraught with trauma, and it all comes back to that fear of our own bodies. By the end of the movie, having used her unique anatomy to defend herself against multiple sexual assaults, Dawn embraces her teeth to dispense her own twisted form of vigilante justice. With great power, there must also come great responsibility. Teeth bridges the gap between body horror and superhero stories by subverting the trope that body horror protagonists must pay the ultimate price. Like Peter Parker, Reed Richards, or Tony Stark, Dawn O'Keefe is empowered by her tragedy. Teeth is a superhero movie. There are so many more examples of body horror to be found in the superhero genre, and it would be impossible for me to go into all of them in just one video. From the Joker falling into a vat of chemicals and his encounter with the plastic surgeon from hell in 1989's Batman, to Wolverine being turned into a living weapon by having his skeleton coated in liquid adamantium, and even this scene in X-Men, which sees Senator Kelly being turned into Senator Jelly. Superhero movie directors often pull from the vocabulary of horror in order to raise the stakes and drive up the human drama in these larger-than-life stories. Even in the pages of monthly comics, with storylines like the recent Immortal Hulk and Absolute Carnage, Marvel and DC continue to toe the line between heroes and horror. Meanwhile, the James Gunn-produced Brightburn from earlier this year poses the question, what if Superman's origin really was a horror movie? While they may seem like strange bedfellows at first, the dynamic duo of superheroes and body horror are here to stay. From Caped Crusaders to Corporeal Invaders, and everything in between. Thank you for watching this video. I've been Josh from Panels Pixels, and until next time, I'll say good night, and don't let the radioactive spiders bite.